What is float in a construction schedule? Float should be in every construction schedule. And I get asked all the time, should we always have float? Should we not have float? Where do we put it? What kinds of things can I expect when I put it in there? And will the owner allow it? The other thing is, what do you do if the owner doesn't allow it? All these questions we're gonna answer in this video. So let me start off by saying that float in a construction schedule is the amount that the activities either together as a network or an independent activity can move without affecting the overall schedule. So this is basically the amount the schedule can move or push without actually affecting the end date, or in my definition, stacking activities needlessly. So it's contingency, it's a buffer. And I prefer the term buffer because we want to buffer impacts. All right. And every schedule should have it. When you take CPM training, the traditional way that CPM is done, in the textbooks, it does in fact talk about having schedule contingency. However, the definition of a longest path is the longest path of activities where if any of the activities were delayed, it would delay the entire project schedule. And a lot of times owners will not allow float or contingency or buffers at the end. They want you to back up your substantial completion date right to the end of that activity and have a critical path on the project. And what the owners will use that critical path for is to not enable you to have a time impact analysis, meaning don't give you more time or money for an actual impact on the project if it's not actually on that critical path. And as we've talked about in other videos, critical path is a really not great way to measure a construction schedule. Bottom line, what we're trying to talk about today is, what is construction float? What is float in a construction schedule? And the answer is, float, the way it's supposed to be used, is to absorb delays. Every construction project will have delays. Every construction project will have problems. And so throughout the course of the project, when you have that delay or that missing material procurement or the rain day or whatever the case may be, you need the ability to move that construction schedule to the right and sustain a delay and then eat into, that's my terminology, but use a buffer day or contingency or float, okay? And so every schedule should have it. There shouldn't be any construction schedule in the entire world that doesn't have float, contingency, or buffers. The reason is because every project will have problems. So if you don't believe me on this, let's analyze it. Out of all of the construction projects in the world, how many of them will go perfectly? Of all the construction projects in the world, how many will not even sustain one delay? Of all the construction projects in the world, how many of them will have every activity just hit perfectly, each and every one? Zero? If you said zero, then that's how many schedules with no float that I'll allow you to have. I said that before in another video, but the bottom line, it's true. We shouldn't have projects without float. So out of all the construction projects in the world, how many have problems? How many have delays? How many have issues that come up? All of them. And so all of them should have buffers, contingency, or float. So how do you identify it? Well, you do a risk analysis, and actually this is in the book called How Big Things Get Done. It's beautiful. There's two ways to do this. Number one, look for your black swans or your big risks and quantify days and dollars for them, and then ask yourself, are my risks and days covered with the float, the contingency, or the buffer at the end of the schedule? The other thing is, you must anchor properly, meaning if you have a certain type of project, can you find representative examples of that same type of project done elsewhere and put them into a database, the database the author has, or your own Excel spreadsheet, and calculate how much the overrun is for the schedule on average across all of those types of projects in that region if you can. And then that will give you an anchor of how far over projects typically are for that type of work. So you can either add that time into the actual schedule itself, or make sure that that, in addition to your risk days, is added in as buffers, as float, or as contingency in your schedule. But either way, you know these problems are going to happen. There's no sense in having wishful thinking. It ain't gonna happen. And the problem is, if you don't use float, if you don't use your contingency and your buffers in your schedule, then when that end of schedule starts to compress, you'll start stacking trades, you'll start hurting people, and that's why project teams start to crash land. The other thing that I would say is, every business out there that does construction is like, how is it that when we start a project, we're good, a third of the way through, we're good, two-thirds, we're good, just after two-thirds, we're like, oh, we're looking bad, a little bit over that, we're like, oh, we're in trouble, and then now we're in a full-blown crash landing, and owners are pulling their hair out, being like, oh my gosh, like, how is it that we find out so late? It's because the schedulers and the supers and the PMs are dissolving logic at the end because they don't have float, contingency, or buffers in their schedule to absorb delays. Instead, they start dissolving logic, stacking people, and hurting the entire project, which will actually only extend the project in reality. And so I know you're asking yourself, hey, how do I get these videos all the time and in my inbox or on my feed? And the answer is you subscribe down below and like this video if you don't mind. Anyway, I know you weren't asking that. You're probably asking yourself, really, okay, my owner says we have to use CPM. My owner says that we cannot have contingency and that any float is shared float between the owner and the contractor or the owner, architect, and the contractor. I don't have any ability to absorb delays. What do you do now? Well, first and foremost, you pack your stuff and you run to the hills because you are in trouble. Actually, that's not really a solution. But what you do is I would first analyze your risks and analyze your anchor, your risks and your anchor. Remember, your risks are the projected possible non-force majeure risk that could happen to the project, and your anchor is, for that type of project, what historical projects can you find and analyze how far they went over schedule and use as an anchor. I would show that data to the owner and ask for the float, the contingency, or the buffers. If you can't get it, I still would not resort to hiding the buffers throughout, because that is a problem. If you read Eli Goldratt's book on critical chain, you'll understand why. The buffers, the contingency, and float should be at the end of the schedule. I'll leave that for another day, but if you ever want to read up on it, the book's called Critical Chain Theory. What I would do is craft a schedule that showed how critical some of these paths are and make sure that I'm tracking any of these paths, any delays that might happen, and have this schedule accurate enough to where I actually could be granted a time impact analysis. Now, there's something that pairs with this. If you know, hey, there's a risk of 30 days that this project is going to be behind schedule, but the owner won't give us any buffers or contingency or float, and you do have the option of having a time impact analysis submitted and approved, I would at least make sure their owner move-in or their tenant move-in date is set beyond the risk profile. This is huge because if you are building a multifamily building and these 30 days of buffers you wanted in here and they didn't give them to you and they're planning to move people on here, you don't have any choice but to finish right here, and that's going to end up hurting people. So at least ask your owner to target the move-in date, the tenant move-in date, or the owner move-in date past what I call the risk profile. And so float should not be in contracts only a shared float, and we should not, as owners, beat contractors over the head for delays that could not have been prevented. We should enable them to use float, contingency, and buffers, 100%. And we should never hurt people with this. So in the book, How Big Things Get Done, the misconceptions of how pushing, the thought process is that pushing really helps projects to go faster. That is a fallacy. It actually extends projects. The concept that bringing in more resources all at once, shortening the durations of projects and helping, is actually a fallacy. It actually extends projects. So if you're an owner and you really want to run a project fast, you will have buffers in there and keep every one of your trades going the same speed, the same distance apart. And you will not stack, and you will not crash land, and you will not push that team, and you will not overburden the project with resources. And so I'm going to link you to a blog post in the description below that explains this in more detail. But the bottom line is, float or contingency or buffers should be there to absorb delays. Every schedule should have it. Every schedule should have that ability. And if you have an owner that won't let you have it, you need to dig deep and find a way to get it, because if you don't, you'll only end up hurting people. I hope you have enjoyed this video. On we go.